My name is Charlotte Herzeel. I work at IMEC, which is a research center in Belgium. And more specifically, I work at the EXA Science Lab, which is specialized on software and code optimization with applications within the life sciences domain. And today I will be talking about one of the software packages that we developed for processing sequencing data called LPREP. So what is LPREP? Well, it's a software package for processing aligned sequencing data. And it has been designed to be a drop-in replacement for tools implemented by software packages such as JTK or SAMTools or Picard, with the idea that the output that LPREP produces is identical. But the software is designed to be a multi-threaded program that optimizes RAM use and merges the execution of multiple pipeline steps in order to avoid repeated file I/O and to overall speed up the execution time. So we've seen that we can speed up the execution time by roughly a factor 13, depending on the workload. So it's developed as an open source project, which you can download on GitHub. It's developed in the Go programming language by Google, and we are very welcoming contributions. So it's currently used at various Belgian hospitals, but also at a couple of companies such as Bluebee, Janssen Pharmaceutica, and a couple of other institutes. So this year we've actually published a paper on LPREP, on the software, and how it is supposed to be used at PLOS ONE. So most of you will probably know this, but if you look at the computational phases of sequencing pipelines, you will see that there are largely three different phases, an important phase being the mapping phase, where the raw reads from the wet lab are mapped to a known reference genome, and there is a variant calling phase where those mapped reads are analyzed for variants. And in between those phases, there's kind of a bump processing phase, which is responsible for massaging the data into a format that is more appropriate for statistical analysis. So it will do kind of various statistical steps to make the variant calling more efficient. So there are many different tools for each of these steps, and the software package that I will be talking about today, LPREP, mainly focuses on the BAM processing phase currently. So if we zoom into that BAM processing phase, we see that it's kind of a pipeline on its own. So what could be in there? For example, there could be a step to sort the reads by coordinate order, or you could have a step to mark the optical duplicates or the PCR duplicates, or you could perform base quality score recalibration or replication, and so on. So the standard approach and how these pipelines are currently implemented is to implement each of these steps by a separate command line tool. And these command line tools are then combined via scripts. But this has a number of drawbacks from a performance perspective. First of all, there's a lot of repeated file I/O, as each of the tools needs to parse in a BAM file and produce a BAM file as output that can be used as input to the next tool. This also puts a severe limitation in terms of the parallelization that you can achieve in these tools, because these different invocations introduce explicit synchronization steps. This means that each tool has to wait for a previous tool to finish before it can start processing. On top of that, there's a lot of repeated iteration over the same data sets, and because these are sequencing data, this actually matters in terms of runtime, because these are very large data files that need to be processed in the order of hundreds of gigabytes. So a few years ago, we came up with the idea to replace this type of software architecture by a new software architecture where the idea is that a BAM file is processed by making only a single pass through that BAM file, independent of the number of steps that need to be applied to process it. And we've implemented this architecture as a concrete tool that we call LPREP. So what's the current state of LPREP? Well, we have implemented various filters and operations that you may find in other software packages, and we've currently focused on supporting the JTK best practices pipelines. So we support them for mainly for DNA sequencing, but also for other applications, depending on what our users are requesting. It's actually released as a standalone and very flexible command line, a binary with a very flexible command line interface. And at the bottom of the slide, so here, there's actually an example command line invocation of lprep. And this command will actually work. So what you have is you have the actual command invocation, and you have an input bum file and an output bum file. And below that, you have a number of operations that you may want to apply to the bum file. For example, a first operation to sort the reads by coordinate order, then an operation to mark duplicates, mark optical duplicates, generate metrics files to apply BQSR, and so on. And this command is all you need to execute that pipeline. It will actually work. So no need for long scripts. What is special about lprep is that it's really designed to be a drop-in replacement for other tools, which means that we try to match the output of those existing tools. And this is really binary identical. So you will get the same BAM files as output, but also the same metrics files as output. And of course, your standard tools for inspecting those BAM files and metrics files will still work. So you can use MultiQC or whatever tool you want to inspect those metrics files and BAM files. So the challenge with lprep, of course, is that we have to develop new algorithms that improve the performance, parallelize them, but we have to do this without changing the semantics of the original algorithms. The software is also designed to be in a modular and extensible framework. And the way we achieve this is by introducing various intersection points or hooks where other developers can implement their own filters or operations. The way that this works is that the software is organized as a phased filtering architecture. So in a first phase, the software will read in the BAM file into memory, and a first set of filters can be applied. Then there is a second phase where whole memory operations are applied, for example, sorting or BQSR. And finally, there's a third phase where the BAM file is written back to disk, and during which another set of filters can be applied. And at each of these points, a developer can introduce new filters or new operations to implement their own tools. And the nice thing about this is that the parallelization is actually separate from this implementation. So you don't need to touch that part. The parallelization engine of lprep is separate from that. So let's take a look at an example filter submitted by a user. So this is a filter that I submitted where the idea was to have a simple filter to remove reads that do not pass a certain mapping quality. So this is implemented as a higher order function. So at the top line, you see the function definition. It takes a parameter, a mapping quality. Then there are a couple of lines for a corner case. We can safely skip those. And at the bottom of the slide, you see that a function is returned. And this function is interesting to look at. So first of all, the function will take a header object, which is a representation of the sum header, as a parameter. And it will return a filter that operates on an alignment. And if we look at the filter for the alignment, we see that's, again, a function which takes an alignment object as a parameter, so a representation of a single read. And then you have the body of that function, which implements the actual operation, which is, in this case, is a test on the mapping quality. And depending on whether this returns true or false, that read will be kept into the final output. And this is actually the only thing that the developer had to implement that filter. They didn't have to touch the parallelization code in lprep. So okay, let's take a look at the performance. So on this slide, we make a comparison of the raw performance of lprep, and we compare it to the performance of JTK4. And we look at a pipeline that consists of four steps from the JTK best practices, which is sorting the BAM file, marking optical and PCR duplicates, and base quality score recalibration and application. So there are three benchmark graphs shown on the slide from left to right. You have a graph that shows the runtime, a graph for the memory use, the peak memory use, and a graph for the peak disk use. At the top of the slide, you always have the numbers for the GTK4 run of this benchmark, and at the bottom of the slide, you have the numbers for LPREP. Now, for LPREP, there are two different numbers, like the black bars and the purple bars, and that's because LPREP has two execution modes. One mode allows you to execute the benchmark in memory, and the other mode allows you to favor disk use instead of memory use. So that's why there are two numbers for LPREP. So if you look at the runtime graph at the top, we see that the runtime for GATK is the combined runtime of each of the individual steps in the pipeline. And that's because there is no way of merging those steps. Whereas with LPREP, you have only one number because it's, of course, the combined runtime for the pipeline. And if we look at this, we see that depending on the mode that you use with LPREP for this whole exome sample, you get between 5 and 13 times speed up. Let's take a look at the peak RAM use. There we see kind of a similar story. Depending on the mode of LPREP you use, you will use between less RAM or 2.6 times more RAM than GATK4. And if you look at the peak disk use, then independent of the mode in LPREP you use, you will use actually less peak disk use, between 0.6 and 0.2 times the disk use of GATK4. And all of this happens while producing identical output. So it's really a drop in replacement. In addition, we have done a scaling experiment on Amazon Web Services, where we wanted to see what the scaling behavior was of LPREP. So if you allocate more resources to LPREP, what will the performance be, and what will be actually the cost of running on a bigger node? And we've also compared that to GTK4 on these slides. So on this slide, you see two graphs. On the left hand, you see a cost graph, so the cost to run a particular job in dollars. And on the right-hand side, you see the runtime of those jobs. The red lines are the benchmarks for GATK4, and the green and blue are the numbers for LPREP, again, depending on which mode you are using. So let's take a look first at the runtime benchmarks, which is on the right-hand of the slide. Let's first take a look at GATK4. If you look at the x-axis, you'll see that we've run the benchmark on different Amazon Web Services instances, which each increase the number of CPUs and RAM. And we see for GTK4, so the red bars, we see some scaling behavior. So GTK4 has benefit from giving access to more hardware resources. But if you compare it to the numbers of LPREP, the green and the blue bars, we see that LPREP scales better, so it can better make use of more hardware resources. Because if you see from each jump to a higher instance, we see that the runtime nearly halves, which is almost perfect linear scaling. So how does this relate to the cost? Well, we have to then look at the left graph. So if we take a look at the JTK costs, because of the fact that the software doesn't scale that well, the cost for increasing the resources, the hardware resources, goes steeply up. Whereas if you look at the LPREP runs, the cost more or less stays stable. And that's because the software actually can take advantage of more hardware resources. So if your software scales well, you can actually go to a bigger node, have a faster execution time, and it will not necessarily cost you more. So that's, I think, an interesting thing to observe. Yeah, there's some numbers, like the fastest LPREP run is 15 times faster than the fastest GTK4 run, and cheaper. So we've also done benchmarks on whole genome sequencing. So this is for a public 50x whole genome sample aligned against HG38. And we kind of see a similar story. We have, again, three benchmark graphs. And the conclusion is that LPREP executes that pipeline about 7.5 times faster. It uses less RAM, and it uses less disk space, and it produces, again, identical output. For comparison, we've also done a benchmark to compare with JTK 3.8. And of course, there is an improvement in performance when you switch from JTK 3 to JTK 4. So, but for reference, we see that LPREP executes that same pipeline about 18 times faster, and I guess uses a bit less RAM and a bit less disk space. But the caveat is that the output is not identical, and that's because with LPREP we're following the JTK 4 code base, which has a little bit of a different output compared to JTK 3. Again, we have also done this scaling experiment on Amazon Web Services, and we see that the fastest LPREP run is 6 times faster than the JTK run. The thing is, what JTK does support is that it can spill over to disk, which may be useful if you want to run in very low memory footprints, which is currently something that we haven't implemented yet in LPREP, but we could consider adding this if there's a demand. This actually brings me to the end of my presentation. So what is LPREP? Well, it's a tool for very fast processing of aligned sequencing data. On average, it can give you a factor 10 speed up compared to other tools. It's really designed to be a drop-in replacement for the functionality that it implements for JTK4, some tools, and Picard with identical output. We currently support, for example, all of these preparation steps recommended by the broad best practices for variant calling. A whole genome takes about less than 3 hours, a whole exome less than 3.5 minutes on regular Xeon servers, so no special accelerators were used in these benchmarks. It's released as an open source project developed in Go. The code base currently is around 14,000 lines of code, which is very compact because, for example, if you would look at the implementation of a single tool in, for example, JTK, you would already have a couple of thousand lines of code, for example, for BQSR on its own. And this is the whole framework. So it just supports BAM processing, VCF processing, and things like that. If you want to read more about the software, we've recently published, well, this year we've published two papers. The first one is in PLOS ONE, and it's an article that describes the architecture and the algorithms and how we parallelize them. And the second paper is a paper where we motivate our choice for picking Go as a programming language, where we actually looked into using Java, Go, or C++, and we did a couple of performance benchmarks, re-implementations of LPREP, and we decided to stick to Go. Okay, that's my talk. Thank you.